Hello, I'm Carl Grossman. With 100,000 members, the Union of Concerned Scientists is the biggest and most influential group in the world, calling for science to be used for a humane future. That next on Enviro Close Up. Our guest, Dr. Henry W. Kendall, is a professor of physics at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where the Union of Concerned Scientists, which he chairs, was founded in 1969. The founding statement began, "Misuse of scientific and technical knowledge presents a major threat to the existence of mankind." And it was necessary, the statement goes on, for a majority of concerned scientists to gather together and do something about it. Dr. Kendall, how did the UCS begin?
Well, it began with the concerns that began to rise up in the late 1960s about the war. It had been in Vietnam, but it was eventually a war in Southeast Asia. And part of the student activism and concern over that. It also was related to the buildup of the nuclear arms inventories, the nuclear arms race. And at that time, there was a controversy starting, which was very similar to the Star Wars controversy of the last few years. And all these things together caused unhappiness and unrest in the scientific community, among students at MIT, Harvard, many universities. And the Union of Concerned Scientists flowed together to give expression to these concerns, to take the feelings of senior authoritative scientists to the public, to the government, and try and bring some control over the war, over the nuclear arms race, over environmental pollution, which was also beginning to attract more and more attention.
It's unusual for scientists to kind of organize themselves in a political action group or a social change group. Was there some discussion at that point in the late 1960s, like, what are we doing?
Well, I don't think there was much concern about whether the group should be doing that. It was clear that something had to be done. The nuclear arms race was beginning to run out of control. There had been many people in the scientific community who had been concerned for many years about nuclear weapons, the immense inventories. The two contestants in that grim contest, the Soviet Union and the United States, were in the midst of building enough nuclear weapons, hydrogen bombs, to fry the earth. And it was, of course, enormous concern. And then other things began to crowd in. Environmental degradation, that was becoming an issue. It was no problem about the scientists doing something. The question was what? And the Union of Concerned Scientists formed in a way to express and to channel these feelings, to see something useful done.
The statement goes on about how there's a small group of scientists that helps to conceive these policies, speaking of non-life-affirming policies, the spread of death through science. What was that group doing and why was it doing it?
Well, you should understand there's been a lot of controversy about nuclear arms, about military power, military buildup. But to put it clearly, the United States exists in a dangerous world, and we have always had and have to have, well into the future, a secure military arm, secure military forces, a thorough defense policy. But what we do not need is one that gets carried too far, like the nuclear arms race. So it is a legitimate thing for scientists to help the government on weapons problems, provided that things do not get out of hand. But there was a widespread feeling in the 1960s among scientists who had been in nuclear weapons programs in the government that things were getting out of hand. That was what the group, among other things, the Union of Concerned Scientists, was formed to deal with.
One of your first fights in the national security arms control field involved the proposal of the Nixon administration for anti-ballistic missiles.
Yes, that was the early Star Wars program, almost like the one we've had during the Reagan years.
Essentially, you succeeded, I suppose, in retrospect, I mean, after all the decades, in stopping that sort of thing, or have you totally?
It has been pretty much stopped. The controversy in the Nixon years did end successfully with a wonderful treaty, an arms control treaty, that prevented the spread of missile killers, which it turns out is not a good thing. Then we had this same controversy visited again on us by President Reagan. But that, too, has succumbed to technical weaknesses, to over-advertising, but it still did quite a bit of damage to this country through the expenditure of vast sums of money, well over $30 billion, on an enormously miscast program. But it does look like it is now coming under control.
And what do you say to people who point to the Persian Gulf War and the Scud missiles and say, hey, we need anti-ballistic missile systems of some sort, whether it's a Patriot missile or something more elaborate?
We certainly need devices for the battlefield that will deal with missiles coming in on the battlefield, the sorts of things that the U.S. Scud missile was supposed to do but did not quite measure up to. That is not the same thing as the Star Wars program that President Reagan outlined as a dream and a vision, which was unachievable, which would have actually made the problems worse that it was designed to solve. They're two different things. And I and my colleagues generally believe that there should be research on defenses for armies in the field that will protect them against missiles of the sort that Saddam Hussein had and used.
Right after this, the Union of Concerned Scientists moves on civilian nuclear power.
Neat trick, huh? But did you know that every time you burn leaves, you're creating air pollution and a health hazard? And not just in your own backyard, but for your neighbors, too. But it doesn't take a magician to change this picture. With a little work, you can compost your leaves instead of burning them. Use this compost on your garden, and you can share something more healthy with your neighbors. A cleaner environment, the best trick of all.
For more information, contact your local cooperative extension office.
This is Milt Wirtz in the lab. Research indicates that we Americans create garbage at an alarming rate. To alleviate disaster, I have come up with a solution. Worms, garbage-eating worms. This subspecies can go through a pound of garbage in no time, and I've got bigger ones out back.
There's an easier way to save the world. Recycle. For your free recycling action guide, write Recycle. Environmental Defense Fund, 257 Park Avenue South, New York, New York.
In 1972, the Union of Concerned Scientists raised some rather serious questions about so-called emergency control systems, emergency core cooling systems in nuclear plants in the U.S. And that actually begins, in many ways, the anxiety, the worry about nuclear power plants. Dr. Kendall, explain perhaps what the issue was way back then about emergency cooling systems and whether the problem has been solved.
Well, I don't think the problem has been solved. And what has happened over many years is that many, many more problems related to that and unrelated to it have surfaced that have serious safety aspects with respect to civilian nuclear power and other problems which many people know about of costs. In the late 50s and the 1960s, the nuclear power program was pushed up by great enthusiastic government support. Manufacturers started building nuclear reactors which were bigger than anything that had ever been tested. They were rushed into production. And it turns out, in retrospect, a little too fast, a little carelessly. And by the late 1960s, they were discovering that they didn't understand how accidents could happen. They were beginning to understand that accidents could be devastating on scales that they had no idea of when they had started the program, really. And they discovered through their own tests carried out by the government that vital cooling systems that were needed in the case of an accident would very likely be ineffective. And my colleagues and I raised that issue. We raised it formally in hearings with the Atomic Energy Commission, which was the government agency responsible. And it turned out in very massive hearings that went over a couple of years, 20,000 pages of documents of record and transcripts, that many of our fears were genuine and that they were shared by government scientists. And that was the first heavy technical body of evidence that showed that reactors were not what they had been advertised to be, that in fact they posed significant risks. The controversy has not ended.
There were many reports. There are many reports published by UCS on nuclear power plants. Reactor safety studies is one. I mean, these days you're still churning out reports about the so-called advanced nuclear power plants that are being promoted as a kind of a new brand of nuclear power facilities. What was your feeling when the Three Mile Island accident occurred in 1979 after all this work through the 1970s about nuclear power?
Well, that was the second serious accident in the nuclear program. There had been a fire at a Browns Ferry reactor in Tennessee, in Alabama, I guess. That also had very serious safety implications. We were afraid that the message we were bringing to the government, to the Congress, was not being heard, that matters were not being cleared up that were known and of great safety concerns. So it was a great unhappiness to see an accident like Three Mile Island come so very close to being really, truly catastrophic. It was just an accident that it did not really get loose. An engineer came back to the plant early, half an hour before his shift started. He happened to catch a vital valve that was closed by mistake. If he had not come there, the plant, according to the government studies after the accident, was within 30 minutes of a meltdown.
And speaking of meltdowns, speaking of nuclear accidents, Robert Pollard, who was a former engineer for the Atomic Energy Commission and the agency that replaced it, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, pointed in the 1970s to the Indian Point nuclear plants. They're just 28 miles north of New York City, as he put it, accidents waiting to happen. And you, the Union of Concerned Scientists, which now employs Robert Pollard, try to shut down those plants, but they're still churning away, they're still operating today.
Some are, but in fact, the utility very reluctantly heard the advice, and the worst of the plants at Indian Point is indeed shut down and will never run. And we have directly, Mr. Pollard being primarily responsible, have moved to see two other plants shut down based on Union of Concerned Scientists studies carried out by Mr. Pollard. So we have a good track record, and we have not been wrong in our concerns.
We'll be back with Enviro Close-Up and Dr. Henry Kendall right after this.
Farmers and fellow mountain goats, this year's recipient of the treasured Black Horn Award, Richard Lynch. Come on up here, Dick.
What are you doing this weekend that's so important you can't take a little time to test your home for radon? After all, it is the second leading cause of lung cancer, and a radon test kit is inexpensive. You can pick one up on your way to the lodge.
Dr. Kendall, you're a Nobel laureate. I mean, you don't need this. I mean, you can be happily teaching at MIT writing books and kind of taking it easy, academically speaking. I mean, like, what motivates you?
Well, I should say that I am happily teaching at MIT and also carrying on research there. I have 230 students in a freshman laboratory course, which is just meeting as we now this week have this interview. But I think that people who share my own background in science, who have concerns about the environment, about national security, about problems of population growth which are not understood, really have a responsibility to study these things and take our concerns, because they are thoughtful concerns, to the public, to political leaders, to religious leaders, business leaders, and try and see that and ensure that the future is a decent future. Because we live in perilous times. Environmental degradation has gone a long way, represents a real threat. The nuclear arms race has represented a real threat. And the scientific community and I, among others, want to see something done about that.
And in your life before 1969, were there some events, was there something catalytic which kind of sent you in this direction?
No, I've always been interested in, for example, environmental problems. An outdoor type myself. I've been on a number of mountaineering expeditions and have seen the astonishing beauty of the Earth. I would hate to see it destroyed by carelessness, by inadvertent human actions. And it's worth taking the time to try and save.
A lot of time, though, I bet, huh?
A lot of time. A great deal.
The Nobel Prize you received, perhaps you can describe the research that led to the Nobel.
Well, I shared that prize with two of my close friends and colleagues. We ran a program, two of us from MIT and one at Stanford, on one of the great machines of physics, the 2-mile linear accelerator at Stanford. And we were studying the deepest, smallest basic structure inside the building blocks, which are familiar to many, the neutron and the proton. And we discovered the basic building blocks down deep inside called quarks. It was the experimental discovery of quarks. And it was on that was the basis for the citation for the Nobel Prize.
C.P. Snow, the English writer, way back when I went to college in the 1950s, described two cultures in collision, a culture of science and a culture that he felt was more committed to humanity. Is that an intrinsic conflict?
Well, I'm not sure that the other culture, if you mean things beyond science, is as a whole more committed to humanity. The object of scientific research is to broaden our understanding of the world that we live in, where it came from, what it is like, where it is going, and to bring this understanding to engineering devices to improve the human lot. So I think we all share an interest in improving things for all people. There is a communication gap between science and the many people who are brought up in the non-scientific disciplines. And that has been a very sad thing. Science is complex, it is not understood, and because it is now, science and technology are now a life support system for human beings. We cannot do without that. And if people do not understand its strengths, understand its weaknesses, its limitations, we are all in trouble. And it was that, in part, that Snow was calling attention to. It still persists. It's a big problem.
Right after this, the very remarkable recent World Scientists' Warning to Humanity, which Dr. Kendall was right in the middle of formulating.
The dump site we're proposing is perfectly safe. Trust me.
The people who tell you that nuclear waste dumps are safe are stretching the truth. Trucks carrying radioactive waste will be traveling through our neighborhoods, so no area is safe.
As for our track record, accidents will happen.
You're alive.
Clean it up.
Nuclear waste. The problem is bigger than you think.
That's my dad. And that's mom. Dad's got an idea. A way to get rid of all the grody garbage that's polluting the world. He's invented a big rocket ship to shoot all the garbage into outer space. Mom's not sure. But Dad says his invention will save the world.
There's an easier way to save the world. Recycle for your free recycling action guide, right? Recycle. Environmental Defense Fund, 257 Park Avenue South, New York, New York.
He protects all living things in the forest. But he can't do it alone. Please don't play with matches. Put out your campfires. And never, ever forget the words of Smokey Bear.
Only you can prevent forest fires.
Hope alone can't save our seas, save our soil, or save our skies. Act now. The world can't wait. You are the hope for the future.
In 1992, a very remarkable document was issued, the World Scientists' Warning to Humanity. And Dr. Henry Kendall, right in the center of that warning, what was the warning about?
The warning is about a whole cluster of human activities that are being carried out on an immense scale, and they are putting great, serious, damaging pressures on the global systems that we all depend on, we and all life, for our happiness, for our sustenance, our food, all of these things. Part of these things come, these damaging activities involve environmental damage, but there are others. There is an enormous need to recognize the urgency of this, because we may so mutilate the world if things go on that life cannot continue as it always has. This need, which is recognized in the scientific community, not fully appreciated by governments and by peoples at large, must be addressed. And there is an additional, enormously important obstacle to controlling environmental damage, and that is the need to stabilize population growth. These are now connected, and the message in this World Scientist's Warning is that they are connected, and that the threats are real, and they are affirmed by some of the most senior scientists in the world, including a majority of the Nobel Prize winners in the sciences, the heads of some of the world's most senior scientific academies, and it is a document which speaks to the human problems with the world we live in.
And UCS organized the development, the creation of this statement.
Yes, we did.
And you personally?
I personally initiated it, yes.
How is the document's call? And viewers, get a hold of that document from the Union of Concerned Scientists. It's serious stuff and important stuff. How is the call of the document being received by governments around the world?
Well, it's very slow. People do not want to hear bad news, even if the bad news is tempered by something that is very good. That is the possibility of doing something about these problems. Governments are slow to react. We all know that. We've seen that in the environmental movement in the United States. We've seen it in the women's movement. We've seen it in civil rights. We see it in many cases. Governments like to do what they've been doing, business as usual. But the times now are different. The pressures on the globe are much higher than they have been, and there are times to change. So the work of this warning is slow. It's slow work. And a program is being organized around this by us. It has already started. to work through the world scientific community, to get more scientists in, to realize their responsibilities to help, to communicate with the public as we're doing, and to bring this message forcefully to people who are reluctant to hear it.
With just a couple of minutes left, let's jump back to energy if we could. And speaking of business as usual, the Union of Concerned Scientists in recent years has been calling for implementation of safe alternative energy forms. Why are they not being, in fact, implemented the way the UCS feels they should?
Well, it's the same inertia. It's always convenient to do tomorrow what we did today. It's always inconvenient to reshuffle things, to reshuffle the deck. So these things come slowly, but they are coming. Wind energy has made a spectacular contribution in California. It is spreading slowly as people understand, as the slow work of education, the slow work of facts make themselves apparent to people who plan and organize our energy systems, for example. Higher mileage cars, less polluting cars, less polluting households, factories, ships, rail, all these things move slowly. And it's the scientific community's task to push hard.
Dr. Henry Kendall, professor at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, chairman of the Union of Concerned Scientists, we all thank you.
Thank you very much.